Chapel. We are so glad you're with us today, whether you're here in person or online. Thank you for joining us today. It's going to be a great day. We have Reverend Sammy going to be leading the service for the message this morning, so we're always honored to have him here just always honored to have you here, but double blessed to have you as our speaker today. Again, our service will have some music, we'll have a message, then we will do prayer requests. So at that time of the service, if you're here, we'll ask for the request. If you're online, if you could put those in the comments section. If you happen to be watching this later, you can send those requests to prayer@christchapel.com. So if you put it in the comments section, most likely we'll only get here today. So some people, sometimes we can catch it later, but often we miss it, sorry. So if you can do prayer at Christ Chapel, it'll work. So anyway, we're glad you're here. Let's begin our service and let's start with prayer. If you'd like to join me and stand. God, we thank you for your presence and power in our life. We thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. And God, we're just so grateful to have a day to be able to worship you and to honor you and just lay aside this time to focus on who you are and the blessings you give to us. So God, as we gather in this place, as we gather as a church family, we ask that your Holy Spirit will be here to touch our hearts, to draw us into a closer relationship with you. Anoint the music, anoint the message, O God, and allow us as we leave this place to be so grateful that we spend our time in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. This time, the music team will come in and lead us in song. Thank you.
the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
worship team, can you stay just one more minute? If you'll indulge me for one more minute. And sometimes I feel like we come in here week after week and we sing, but do we really believe that freedom reigns in this place? So I want us to sit with Jesus for a minute, and let's just sing that refrain a couple of more times, and let's just sing that together like we believe that Jesus reigns in this place today. Just a refrain, just a couple of times. Because if we can't get it in this place, where else are we supposed to get it? Can we pray? Benevolent Holy One, we are grateful for this opportunity to come and worship you and to study your word. We ask that you enter this space. Lord, show us what transformation looks like in this moment. We humbly come before you to ask for your favor and blessing on this sermon today, as it is a worship to you. May you bless this message with your wisdom and knowledge. May you help us to take your word and apply it to our lives. Amen. So, if you were here earlier, you may have found out that I'm not the most technologically advanced person. Thank you, Melissa and Chris, for getting my slides uploaded so quickly as you did. And one of the things I found is that sometimes when I prepare my PowerPoints, the wording is a little off. So we're going to go old school today. So if you could take out this thing called your Bible. I don't know if you remember that. Some of you probably have it on the phone if you're a little younger. That's okay. Take it out on your app. And we're going to turn to John, the 4th chapter, the 1st verse, where Jesus runs into a woman from Samaria. So, we'll give you a second to get there. Usually Catherine is my guide. She's my Bible wizard and gives me the thumbs up, and she's found it. So 20 seconds after that, you guys have to find it. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard, Jesus is making and baptizing more disciples than John, although it was not Jesus himself, but his disciples who baptized, he left Judea and started back to Galilee. But he had to go through Samaria. So when he came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph, Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" She was one of the hardest working women that I have had the privilege of knowing. Her tasks literally went from sunup to sundown. There were eggs to be collected, trash to be composted, seeding produce, harvesting that produce, milking cows and brushing goats, and that's just to name a few. And at the end of the day, as she was mending our clothes by hand, we could look at her and tell that Grandma was just tired. We all get tired sometimes, and we live in a country, in a world, where it can be seen as a sign of weakness when you're tired. It leads us to believe that getting tired is wrong. I mean, if we're tired, right, we're not up to the task, or we did not prepare ourselves enough to do what was needed to be done, and we can file the task under our other list of failures, the things that we didn't get right. But the passage that we just read today lets us know that it's okay to be tired. Now, often when we talk about the story of the woman with the well, we talk about her redemption, right, and her faith. But for some reason, this always tends to give her a bad rap for me, focusing just on her sins and her transgressions. We do know from this passage that she was reconciled to God, and that is a good thing. When God comes and shows himself to us and saves us, yes, redemption and faith are very, very good things. And certainly in no way was Jesus fazed by her sins or what she had done, just as God is not fazed by any of the sins that we commit today. But for me, the beauty of this gospel is that we can not only read and interpret it vertically, but it lives and moves in ways that allow us to look at it from different angles. I wonder how the woman in this story got to this place where she was able to meet Jesus. Our Bible doesn't even give the woman a name. She's just the woman of Samaria. I'd like to start by giving her a name today. We can do that, right? We're Christ's Chapel. We can do whatever we want. I would like to call her Samantha. You know, so, or Sam. And I'm not saying that just because, you know, it's, you know, kind of like my name. But I do believe that Sam was a lot like me, and that Sam was a lot like a lot of us here today. Probably like all of us. I think that, you know, Sam was probably a lot like all of us. Sam was a little brassy, a little curious, a little spunky. Sam was a bit different from everybody that was around her. And like me and you, Sam had done some stuff. Some stuff that she probably wasn't proud of. Sam had made some mistakes. She had a past. Sam had some history. I'm sure that when she was a young lady, a young woman, she didn't walk around asking herself, how many husbands should I have? Should I have one? Should I have two? You know what? Five husbands sounds like a good number. You know, it gets me up there. It's not to Elizabeth Taylor, but it gets me in the running. Five sounds like a really good number. See, back in that time, brothers and sisters, sisters, a woman could divorce a man for any reason. Maybe he did not like her body when he saw it. Maybe she lied. He could even divorce her if she couldn't even cook. All he needed to do was to pull her into a public place in front of a few witnesses and said, "I divorce you, I divorce you, I divorce you." And it was done. Women, however, did not have that same option. Sam had to have faced so many rejections at that point that she was simply fed up. Sam was tired and was just trying to survive. Sam was just trying not to be homeless and unhoused. And in addition to being a woman, Sam was also a Samaritan. They were a mixed race of people. They were part Jewish and part Gentile. They were rejected by both the Jews and by the Pharisees. The dislike was not something trivial, it was deep. And they experienced hatred from both sides. You see, marginalizing a group of people based on the race was nothing new. So talk about being an outcast. Talk about being ostracized. Talk about being forgotten. Sam found herself smack dab in the middle of the intersection of gender and ethnicity with no signs of escape. Nothing good about her would ever be said or seen according to social norms. She lived in a world where pure existence constantly beat her down. Her life must have been exhausting. Our friend Sam must have been tired. So what did Sam do? She changed the way she operates. Now it was custom for women to go to the well early in the morning or in the late evening because Samaria was hot and dry and dusty country. No one wanted to be around in the sun in the middle of the day. But Sam, she chose to go around noon when it was hot and arid as it could be. She went at a time when she was less likely to be seen. She went at a time when she could get her water and not have to address her shame with anyone else. How many of us have avoided places or people because we did not want to face our truth? How many of us have hidden in darkness because our reality was too painful to face it in the light? There have been times in some of our lives we've even avoided church. We avoided the sanctuary because we didn't deem it as a safe place to be for us. We were afraid to walk in and to find that person who would just smile in our face and ask how we were doing just so that they could hear the tragedy of our struggle or our story. And then the very moment we turned our back, they go to the person in the next pew and they say, "Ooh, girl, did you know?" Sam was sick of being talked about and scorned. So she found herself at the well of Jacob in the middle of the day where she met Jesus. What was Jesus doing there? There were many ways Jesus would have gotten to his destination. He did not have to go through Samaria. Here's a quick geography lesson on the next slide. Jesus was heading north to Galilee from Judea. He could have chosen to go travel along the coast. He could have gone across the Jordan. Or, as he did, he could have gone straight through Samaria. Now, Orthodox Jews at that time would have avoided Samaria at all costs. So why go through Samaria? I believe that he went there to meet Sam at that well. And this goes to show us that Jesus Jesus will show up in places where we least expect. Now, we certainly expect Jesus to meet us here on Sunday mornings, right? That's why we come. We pray and we invite him in. We are here online because we expect to see and meet Jesus. We come in or turn on our computers, and we're like Miss Rita on Romper Room, the show I used to watch when I was a kid, and she used to grab her magic mirror to see who she could see. And we walk in the doors, and we look around, and we say, I see Jackie, I see Bethany, I see Marcos, I see Pastor. Ooh, look, I see Jesus. I'm so glad to be in church today. But again, Jesus can show up anytime, any place, any form, any shape. We can be at the grocery store, and right when we turn from the baked good aisles into the canned good aisles, and in front of us, boom, there's Jesus. We could be up in the club on a Saturday night doing our favorite dance and turn around and boom, there's Jesus. So it does not surprise me, and it should not surprise any of us, that Jesus showed up at a well in the middle of Samaria for Sam, a place where we would never, ever expect him, a Jewish man, to be. Now, sometimes our pain cuts so deep that we avoid these things that can be life-giving. We avoid these life-giving wells, and we turn to our own wells that we have created repeatedly. We look for things that we can find some type of solace and comfort in. We find them in bad relationships, alcohol, drugs, compulsive shopping, or maybe even chocolate cake. I know I've visited the well of chocolate cake many a times. More than I would probably like to admit. But we also know that the comfort we get from these wells is only temporary. Jesus tells Sam in verse 13, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. And in verse 14, he tells us that the water that I will give will become them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. Jesus is the living water that fills our voids, that replaces our loneliness and our emptiness. It replenishes us when we are tired. Many times throughout my day, I ask people how they are doing, and the number one response I do receive is, I'm tired. If I were a betting person, I would guess that many of us here today, and those of us watching on Facebook, we're tired of it as well. We are tired of war. We are tired of the politics. We are tired of poverty, tired of racism. We're tired of homophobia. We're tired of toxic relationships. We're tired of our financial struggles. We're tired of our illnesses. We're tired of the illnesses of those of the ones that we love. And there are times when we cast our eyes towards heaven and we say, Lord, I am just sick of it. I am sick and I am tired. And then we get that feeling in the pit of our stomach. You know, the one that feels a little bit like guilt. And we begin to tell ourselves, oh no, we have no right to be tired. That we just need to keep on pushing. And we need to continue to fight the good fight. But you know what? It is okay to be tired. It is okay to be downright exhausted. Because all that means is that some way, somehow, we are still doing the work. I believe that Moses got tired when he prophesied to the Israelites. I believe that Jeremiah got tired trying to save his people from doom. I believe that Jonah got tired while he sat in the belly of the whale. Even our Lord and Jesus Christ got tired. Verse 6 of our text today tells us Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by by his journey was sitting by the well. Even Jesus got tired. So what makes you think that we can't get tired? But what do? That's the good news. We need to go and sit with Jesus and be reminded of what it is we have to offer, just like Sam did. We typically have good intentions when we are doing the good Christian work. We go to deliver the message of salvation to others we come across, and we give it as if we're giving them something because we're good Christians. But rarely do we look at the person who is currently wrapped in their own turmoil and sin, who is currently stuck at that proverbial temporary well, and say to them, what can this person offer me? We quickly forget that we're all created in the image of God. When Jesus met Sam at that well, he let her know that despite of who she was, despite of where she had been, despite of all the things she had done, that she had something to offer him, a Jew. He said to her, give me a drink. In his humanity, he was tired and he was thirsty, and our friend Sam had the one thing that Jesus needed. Our tired friend Sam had worth. But she needed to sit with Jesus for just a moment to be reminded of it. As Christians, we live in a world that, due to the acts of others in our faith, our credibility really is in question. It's online, and we can be very judgmental of one another. And we should be trying to be the people that we want to be around. So I'm asking all of us here today to spend just a little more time with Jesus. I'm asking you to just take some time out of your day to just meditate on Jesus. Study the word and allow Jesus to meet you where we are. Allow Jesus to refresh us and bring that living water. I know that some of us might be saying that we are too busy, that we are already doing too much, and this is why we're so tired anyway. Here's a clip that highlights that no matter how busy we are, why it is important to spend time with Jesus.
The world is crowding our souls with noise. Messages, notifications. They begin when our alarm goes off in the morning and continue until we go to sleep at night. The problem is, so much of what we see and hear, the endless information we encounter, it's just noise. It doesn't matter. It's meaningless. But what God has to say to us through His Word, through prayer, through His people, that's different. That's what matters. His presence. It's rest for our weary souls. It's peace for our worried minds. It's hope for our troubled hearts. We don't have to earn His attention. We don't have to work for His love. It's already ours. It is freely given. He's waiting for us to be with Him. There is nothing more important. Nothing matters more than being present with God.
God, I believe that our friend Sam was tired of running. She was tired of secrets. She was tired of all the noise that surrounded her. Just like us, she was tired of the war, the politics, the poverty, the racism, the injustice, the bad relationships, the financial struggles, and the illnesses. Not much has changed since Sam met Jesus at that well, has it? Are you tired yet? I can recall many a day on that farm when my exasperated grandmother would sit on her back porch and sit with God when she could feel her value just plummeting. She would sit there and she would snap peas and she would sing. Without God, I could do nothing. Without Him, I would fail. Without God, my life would be drifting like a ship without a sail. And when she was done, there was something about Grandma that was different. There was a renewal, a refreshment, a rebirth, a rejuvenation, something that made her put more pep in her step and walk around like she had a purpose and worth. She was no longer tired. And Jesus invites all of us to sit with Him. He wants to be that void in our lives that is missing. He wants to offer us that comfort. He wants to give us that living water that cleanses us from the inside and renews us. Jesus wants to be with us when we realize that it's okay to be tired. Can we pray? Almighty God, there are moments we find ourselves on the edge, exhausted and overwhelmed. The burdens seem heavier than we can bear. The tasks are more significant than our strength, and the journey seems way longer than we can endure. We come before you, Lord, knowing that you are our refuge, that you are our fortress, our God in whom we trust. Heavenly Father, you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider and our sustainer. In times of weariness, you are our strength. In times of darkness, you are our light. In times of despair, you are our hope. We place our weary hearts in your hands, trusting in your promise to renew our strength and revive our spirit. It is in the sweet, precious name of the man who met the woman, our friend Sam, at the well, we pray. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And we will now take your prayer requests.
Just safe travels for my best friend Laura up to Sacramento this afternoon.
And I would just like to pray for myself and my friend Tracy succumbed to his battle of cancer this morning. So I would like to pray for him, his family, most importantly, his husband, Philip, as they go through this difficult time. So, can we all just agree in prayer? Oh, gracious and loving God, the God who can do all things, the Jesus who can appear to us anywhere at any time, we come before you, Lord, in this time and in this bless us and work with us as we struggle through these things. Lord, we ask that you take Jackie's friend and that they travel safely, Lord. We ask that it be expedient, that you get them to their destination, and along the way, Lord, you let them see the things and experience the things that they need to see. God, we ask that you bring John before you, Lord, as he is with his mother and he is dealing with health issues, Lord, and it's so difficult, Lord, to deal with illnesses with anyone, Lord, but we just ask that you just have John give him the wisdom and the words to say to his mom and his family, Lord, and just let the doctors be on the mom and the cousin, that you continue to work, Lord, for all that is good, that you let the answers be seen, the medications, the procedure, whatever needs to be done, Lord, that you be that eye in the room to make sure that it's done correctly and expediently. Father God, I bring my friend Tracy before you this morning. You've known him before he was created, Lord, and now he is once again with you. I, Lord, am so grateful for the time that you have loaned him to me for the past 30 years, Lord, and I will be forever in your debt for that friendship. We ask that you send comfort to his husband and his family and to all who knew him in this difficult time. And Father God, we ask that you bless this congregation, a congregation that's in the midst of doing some of the most difficult work at all times, Lord, fighting all the isms that exist around them, Lord, but you have sustained us for 32 years, Lord, and we know that was not without accident. We know that it was with reason and that is with purpose. We ask that you continue to show this congregation our reason, our purpose. Show us our worth, Lord. Show us that it's okay to get tired and to come sit with you, Lord, so that we can be rejuvenated and we can go out and do what elevates and uplifts you. These and all other blessings we ask in Jesus' name, the name above all names. Amen. And Sherry's going to bring the announcements.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome, welcome. Does everybody need to take a moment to be present with God? Let's do it. Father, thank you for this moment. As we all take time just to be with you, and to fill your heart here at CCOV. Amen. Okay. If it's your first time here, welcome. There is a card that is in the front of the pew, either white or yellow, who knows what color it is. Fill that out and put it into the black box on the wall in the hallway, or it could be on the highway at some point in time, you know. And if you have a change of address or any information that you would like for us to know, that's where you want to do it. For you individuals online, you can send that to admin@christchapel.com. We have Bible study going on right now, and on Wednesday night, 7 p.m., in our conference room and on Zoom. Hope is teaching that, and that's our hope. And we are doing the parables, and it is just really amazing. And Hope, you're a wonderful teacher. Thank you for sharing with us. So everybody, that's Wednesday at 7 p.m. We have the homeless count coming up, and with the homeless count, we will have a sign-up sheet. The homeless count is January 23rd at 7:30 p.m. We're usually done before 11 o'clock. Everybody meets right back here in the parking lot, and then we'll go over to our spot where everybody is meeting at that point in time. So I have a sign-up sheet that will be on the back counter. I think I'll call that the information area. We'll have that back there for you, and that's for the homeless count.
Sure, sign up today because we have to
Okay. Okay. So if you want to do the homeless count, have to sign up today. If you're online and you want to do the homeless count, send it to admin or give us a call here at the church so that we can get you in there. We have to get you registered. You can't just show up on Tuesday. Okay? We have the retreat coming up. Don't have a sign-up sheet for that yet. It's still a little early, but it's going to be September 27th through 29th. So everybody can put that in their calendars, September 27th through the 29th. And I also have one other little sign-up sheet. It's for hospitality. If you'd like to bring something in and help support Bobby, then sign up and bring something in. Everything is welcome. We can't use it this week, we'll use it next week. But you're always welcome to bring in some goodies. Building fun, Olga, thank you so much, you and Bobby. Thank you for the beautiful 32nd anniversary celebration and the building fund donation that was made through your luncheon. Absolutely amazing. Thank you very much. Let's just take a moment and bow our head in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much for this amazing community that we have here at Christ Chapel. And if we could all spend our time with you, I know we would be. But we have work to do here. May all of us feel free in our heart to give what we can to the building fund and also to our offerings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And join us afterwards for goodies from Bobby. Thank you all.
Please stand as we sing the last song.